born on June 8, 1810, and died July 29, 1856. His parents were very engaged in his academic life and his literary activities. He began studying piano in 1817 with J.G. Kunsch. Schumann had already shown an interest in music, and Kunsch was an organist at St. Berea in Hamburg, Germany. He met Ignaz Moscheles in Carlsbad, and that sort of spurred on his musical interest. The first selection I'll be playing from will be from Kinderszenen. Clara, it was written from a comment made by Clara, his wife. She made a comment saying that he was childish, sometimes acted childish. Out of the 30 original pieces, only 17 are in Kinderszenen. The remaining 17 are found in other various works. The work is one to take on new meanings, and what I mean by that is that this is around the time that pieces were not very much commissioned by anyone in particular. People were just beginning to start writing music just for the sake of writing the music. The pieces are supposed to be a reflection for adults on their childhood. The first piece that you'll be hearing tonight is named Begebenheit. The piece is number 6 in Kinderszenen. It translates loosely to an important event. The piece is constantly moving and reminds me of a child seeking someone's attention. If anyone's ever worked with children, they know that whenever a child has something on their mind they want to speak to an adult about, they're constantly bugging someone or trying to get their attention. It's in ternary form, so ABA. This A section seems to be the child seeking the adult's attention, and then the B section is what I like to think of as the child having caught the attention of the adult and explaining it. And I feel like Schumann personified this by the constant moving descending bass line. You can see that in the lower image on the screen. I feel like that the repeated A section at the end is the child has found something new to talk about or new to explain to an adult. And so they're taking that time, or they're trying to seek the attention of an adult. Now I'll be playing a recording of Wichtige Begebenheit. The CDL is the Child Development Lab at Berea College. They usually cater to any individual associated with Berea College, so as students who as children or faculty or staff member with children, they give them priority before accepting other children from the community. So during the nap time at the CDL, they'll often sort of music in the background while the children are resting their bodies. This piece is also in ternary form. I feel like the reharmonizations of this piece are symbolic. I feel like the original A section is sort of drifting off to sleep, whereas in the B section it reharmonizes a specific phrase twice. I feel like this is a personification again of maybe a dream or something, or a nightmare, I don't know. I feel like it's more calm than to be a nightmare. And then it modulates to the subdominant, and what the subdominant is the fourth scale degree in a diatonic scale. And that maybe harmonizes or tonicizes to the subdominant in the E section, and then tonicizes the original tonic. I'll now go play the piece. Thank you. next composer that I'll be talking about is Sofia Gubaidulina. She's a 20th century composer. The 20th century is known for atonal pieces, or 12-tone pieces, or pieces of impressionistic or minimalist. She was born in 1931 in Chistful, the Tartar Autonomous Republic. She started her musical studies at the Kazan Conservatory of Music. She was taught by Nikolai Paiko, a pupil of Dmitri Shostakovich, where some people tried to shut her down or give her, to bully her into not creating music. Shostakovich was actually a person that sort of encouraged her and gave her strength where in some of her times of need. She supported herself in her prime composition life, writing pieces for movies. She's interested in both Eastern and Western styles of music. A lot of music people will already understand that Eastern styles of music completely differ from Western styles of music. She refers to herself as the place where East meets West. She also thinks that, or says that, composing is a religious experience. Musical Toys was written in 1969. It's one of her lesser known works. It was written for children. However, I and a lot of other musicians will argue that some of these pieces, a lot of them are way too difficult for children to play. There's a quote that she said she would have liked to have played them as a child. And I think it's possible for a child to definitely learn these pieces and perform them, but there's a lot of technical skills required that go into these pieces that sometimes a child just struggles with. The first piece that you'll hear is called April Day. It's the fifth piece in Musical Toys. I feel like this piece sounds chaotic because it's constantly moving, and it reminds me of Crisis because it's constantly moving. Centered around G, atonal music means that it doesn't have a tonal center or a tonic or a subdominant or something. So this piece is centered around G without making G its primary or tonic. The piece has a lot of chordal and quintal structures. Chordal and quintal means that there's a lot of fourths or fifths. And I will now play a recording of this from my computer. This piece is again centered around D. This piece has a lot of repeated phrases, which you can see on the image onto the left. was born on March 7, 1875, and died on December 28, in 1937. His early musical inclinations were encouraged by his father, so that's pretty self-explanatory. He was encouraged to do any musical thing that he wanted to do. His first musical instructors were Henry Gies and, for piano, and Charles René for harmony. He studied at the conservatoire under Emile de Combes. He later studied under Charles Wilfred Berio, and won first place in a piano competition. Later in life, he was criticized and compared to Debussy. However, he felt that his pieces had something different to say rather than they were just a copy of Claude Debussy. The first piece that I'll be playing from Ma Mère Ilyich is called, this translates loosely to Mother Goose Suite. It was originally written in 1910. It was first performed for the Independent Musical Society in France. The piece that I'll be playing is called the Pavane de la Belle, au bois dormant. This translates to the Pavane for the Sleeping Beauty. The piece is eerie, and I think that's a callback or Ravel relating to the original story of the Sleeping Beauty, which is that the Sleeping Beauty was cursed and placed under a slumber for 100 years. There's some various reiterations of this work and that story, so you can look those up. The piece is slow and soft, and it follows an A, B, C, B form. The childhood knowledge that we have on him is based on accounts written by his caretaker and a biography written about him by his brother. His caretaker was Fanny Durbach. She called him Le Petit Pushkin, as he was sensitive to words. This is a reference to Alexander Pushkin, a Russian poet. His brother, Modest Tchaikovsky, also wrote a biography about him. He claimed in his biography that Tchaikovsky's childhood environment wasn't conducive to his learning. This could be for many number of reasons, such as money insecurity or just lack of parental care or involvement. He was enrolled at Potensk at age eight. He struggled to part with his mother when she left him there to study. His classmates had positive thoughts about him. However, they often claimed that he was a bit absent-minded. His formal music training didn't begin until he was 21. So, and he's a pretty beloved musician and composer, so I could say something about our generation as well. Tchaikovsky loved to work with children. I wasn't able to find any accounts of his interactions with children, but he was very interested in building up children. The next composer that I'll be talking about as well is Sergei Rachmaninoff. He was born on March 20th or April 1st of 1873 and died on March 29th in 1943. He started piano with his mother, Anna Romanskaya. They lived in Oneg, Russia. However, his father spent all of the money that they had, so that led to them selling any other estates that they owned. Eventually, Oneg was sold to pay off more debt. He moved to St. Petersburg and enrolled at the St. Petersburg Conservatory. He received a general education there, and he studied piano with Vladimir Dubensky and studied harmony with Alexander Rubets. He eventually started to fail school just because of not steady home environment. Any child in family studies developmentalist would say that a not steady or steady home environment would lead to a worse education or a more scattered, chaotic learning style. When he moved to Moscow, he enrolled into the Moscow Conservatory, and he lived with Nikolai Zverev. Zverev was a rigorous tutor, so he always kept him in his studies, and he didn't let him goof off and do stuff. Living with Zverev led to his meeting of Tchaikovsky. The reason that both of these composers are back-to-back is because Tchaikovsky originally wrote the Sleeping Beauty Waltz, however, Sergei Rachmaninoff arranged the waltz for four hands. The orchestral version was originally composed by Tchaikovsky and published in 1889. It was commissioned by Ivan Zelevsky and premiered in St. Petersburg in 1890. The piano four hands version was arranged by Rachmaninoff in 1891. Tchaikovsky originally started the commission for this piece and spoke with his own publisher, Peter Jurgensen, about commissioning of the four hands arrangement. Rachmaninoff's cousin, was originally the person asked to arrange this piece. However, he felt that Tchaikovsky would be a better option. Tchaikovsky was, in the end, unhappy with the arrangement. He felt that it lacked any creative or any creation, sort of, and it was just literally a transcription of the orchestral version. And now,
thank you.
born in Nagoya, Japan. He originally started his musical career on the electronic organ. He studied at Osaka University of Arts, but was never classically trained. And Nintendo recruited him for composition and sound programming. The reason that the previous piece, the Sigmund Waltz, and this person doesn't have anything concerning childhood is that this part of the program relates to my own childhood. Sleeping Beauty Waltz was, as many of you may know, part of the Disney film, The Sleeping Beauty. That piece was one of my favorite Disney films growing up. Koji Kondo wrote music for this, has written music for the Nintendo company for many, many years now. He writes music for the Super Mario games and the Legend of Zelda games and many, many others. The first piece that I'll be talking about written by him is called Inside the Castle Walls. This piece was originally composed for Super Mario 64 in 1996. The beginning section is very chromatic, but it doesn't sound like it's crunchy or dissonant. It utilizes a lot of contrary motion and is reharmonized in future, or in later iterations of the same phrase. This phrase is reharmonized, the one on the screen. The second section is reharmonized and it utilizes syncopated rhythm. I'll now be playing a recording from my computer. By the tenor trombonist. The bass rhythm is repeated and reharmonized constantly. You can see that in the first image and the second image as well. The piece is continuously building towards the end. And the reason that I chose these two pieces as a final sort of piece or closing is the music that I heard growing up was mainly Southern Baptist gospel music, and by music, I mean a lot of people singing the soprano line along with a pianist doing whatever they want underneath that. Video games and movie soundtracks were really my only sort of reach out into the other world of music and really inspired me to begin my musical career. And now I'll be playing the credits.
Thank you.
section. And thank you all for coming. So, as many of you probably know, I'm a music major, obviously, but this past semester I've been working with Dr. J on getting an extension, which I have, and adding the Child and Family Studies major. I worked this past summer at the Child Development Lab and fell in love with helping young children succeed and accomplish more goals. And so I really want to do that with my life. And if that involves music or it does not, I feel like that working with children is really an area where I can succeed in life. Anyone else? Awesome. Thank you all for coming.
Jerry's senior seminar, early gallery, will be next, and we've moved that down to room 128, but that will commence in about 10 minutes. So we hope you'll wind your